Today, we're very pleased to have our speaker, Dr. Joseph Chow, and he's an assistant professor in the Department of Civil and Urban Engineering and Center for Urban ITS at New York University. He holds a joint affiliation at the Center for Urban Science and Progress. He's head for the built at NYU, that is the Behavioral Urban Informatics, Logistics, and Transport Laboratory. Dr. Chow's research expertise lies in transportation systems with emphasis on multimodal networks, behavior urban logistics, smart cities, and transport economics. He has over 60 peer-reviewed publications, of which more than 30 are international journal articles. He is the vice chair of the Urban Transportation SIG at Informs Transportation Science and Logistics Society. Prior to NYU, Dr. Chow was the Canada Research Chair in Transportation Systems Engineering at Ryerson University. From 2010 to 2012, he was a lecturer at the University of South California and a postdoctoral scholar at the UC Irvine. He has a PhD in civil engineering from UC Irvine in 2010 and a Master of Engineering and a BS in civil engineering from Cornell University with a minor in applied math. Today he's going to talk about the activity-based market equilibrium for capacitated multimodal transport systems. And without further ado, welcome Dr. Chow.
Thank you, Shaw. Thank you everyone for being here this morning or afternoon or evening, wherever you are. I'm really delighted to be giving this talk today. This is a work that I presented last summer at the ISTTT in Kobe. It's really great opportunity for me to share this work with more people interested in this research. So this research was funded by Canada Research Chairs Program and NSERC Discovery Grant while I was still working at Ryerson. I just moved summer to NYU. So this is work that I did with my PhD student, Shadi Javadian, which you see on the presentation slide. So the problem that I want to point out, to start off with, I want to just describe the problem that we're dealing with here. And basically, we're looking at the setting of travel in the case where there are a lot of multimodal options. So here you can see, for example, a lot of these different transport mode options, such as park and ride, transit, shared bike facilities, et cetera, et cetera. In the context of these design options, travelers respond differently than in the case of, let's say, like a traffic road network, because as opposed to just looking at congestion effects, there's a lot more consideration of a person's travel schedule. So, for example, if they take a park and ride facility to get to work, they would have to leave their car there. So there is a requirement for them to eventually, at the end of the day, return back to that park and ride facility to pick up that car and drive back home. So there's a lot of these dependencies in the trips such that we can't really look at the design of multimodal facilities in the context of just trip behavior, but we have to look at it in terms of activity-based travel scheduling behavior. And that's the main goal here, to develop a model that allows us to evaluate these sensitivities. So to address that kind of question, here's an outline of the talk. Basically, I'll start with motivation, which will lead up to a discussion about this model called a household activity pattern problem for scheduling people's activity patterns. I'll talk also about how that aggregates up to consider interactions between travelers. and I'll propose a solution algorithm. I'll talk a little bit about some computational experiments, and then I'll wrap up. Compared to the presentation I gave at ISTTT last year, this is mostly the same, but I added a couple more slides to provide a little bit more detail where I thought it was appropriate. All right. So if we take a look at multimodal systems designs, it's clear, you know, compared to traffic networks, there's a lot more need to look at heterogeneity in the behavior of users, particularly in the observe mode attributes. So, you know, people might choose to take transit as opposed to car, even though it takes longer to travel by transit because of other observable attributes, right? And these can differ from one person to another. And in addition, there's a lot of these higher resolution considerations in people's travel schedules, right? So people make trip chains, people are scheduling the trips throughout the day, and the multimodal system design has a lot of impact on that. And we also want to consider the fact that these multimodal systems, as opposed to just having uncapacitated nonlinear congested effects, we're looking more at the case where they have physical capacities, right? So like stations have, like for example, parking facilities have a limited number of parking spots to attract travelers to park there for a certain duration of time, right? These load capacities need to be considered. So these various factors make it important for us to look at multimodal systems designs from a different perspective. So as I mentioned, the results of looking at those kind of attributes, it's pretty clear that we do need to look at the demand impact from an activity scheduling perspective, right? So on this slide, you can see some of the more state-of-the-art activity scheduling models or methodologies in the literature, right? There's a lot of literature on discrete choice model based approaches, right? But generally, discrete choice based approaches on their own do not consider so much the capacities or constraint based like space time constraints in their models. there are aggregate activity based equilibrium models. Particularly the work of Lam and Yin, and the follow-up work that they've that William Lam has done with his students. But in those cases, we don't see individual heterogeneity, and that's something that that we do need to account for. And similarly, other work in terms of multimodal super network cases, like in Rents and Tim's work, or the case of Wrecker's HAP model, even they don't add in capacity effects, at least at the time when this work was done. So those are considerations that we needed to make to decide how we wanted to approach this problem. So the way we wanted to look at this was to mirror the multi-commodity flow problem, where you have the multi-commodity flow problem. You have multiple OD demands, OD patterns that share a network, but these are at a trip level in the multi-commodity flow problem, right? And the trip demand, they are sharing the network such that the capacities in the links in the network would constrain how people would choose their routes. One way to solve that is to generate a set of feasible paths from which you allocate the flows onto, right? So we want to look at it in a similar way. So in this case, we're considering if we were able to select a choice set of schedules, and this is an example of various schedules, even for one individual, right? So for one individual, that they might choose to make trips from their home to their activities in a certain pattern or in another pattern. Like, do you guys see my mouse? I'm hoping you can see my mouse movements.
So we do. We do see your mouse.
Okay, great. Alternatively, they might choose not to trip chain instead, right? So you can see those different behaviors as alternate types of schedules. Each of these schedules have a different set of routes, x values, right, which are binary route choice patterns or schedules, right? The t's are the arrival times to the different nodes. And in the case where if we're able to get a set of schedule choices for all the individuals in the population, then perhaps we can assign using a stochastic user equilibrium for these individuals probabilistically onto each of the schedules, right? So that's the idea that we want to look at this problem. So the framework here is that what we're hypothesizing is that there is this capacitated stochastic user equilibrium of schedule choices from which it's drawn from a choice set of a heterogeneous population of activity schedules, and it's sensitive to different multimodal system designs. For this paper that we published, we didn't consider nonlinear congestion effects on the road links. Instead, we wanted to focus primarily on these schedule effects. But certainly, you know, we can go into a more sophisticated travel cost relationships later on. Okay, and in this a framework, the issue then is if we wanted to capture this stochastic user equilibrium, we need to be able to generate a choice set of these schedules for the population, right? So in order to do that, as I mentioned, we relate this to the multi-commodity flow problem, and basically in the multi-commodity flow problem, one way you can generate good paths through a capacitated network for these trips is to use a shortest path problem as a subproblem to generate routes that account for updated dual prices for the capacitated links. Right? We need something analogous to that in generating shortest activity paths. Right? So how can we do that? So this is where Recker's model fits in, because he developed this household activity pattern problem as a normative model for assigning people to schedules, right? So you end up with a case where people are traveling through a space-time network where, you know, they're choosing activity patterns to make such that it optimizes their utility or minimizes their disutility. In their model, however, it did not account for multimodal setting. And I'll illustrate that later on. But basically, there are only activity nodes in this case, and we are able to calibrate the parameters to individuals of the sample, but up to now there has not been any consideration of interactions between the individuals. So in essence, the HAP model is like a shortest path problem, but there was no equilibration or kind of like a capacity effects to look at the interactions of these individuals. So we propose to extend the HAP model to a multimodal graph as one of the requirements for this framework, and we also propose to fit this these individuals HAP operators within an aggregation function so that we can obtain the population level distribution of flows onto activity schedules. And we'll talk about how we do that using a mixed logit framework. And we use that concept to fit it into a stochastic user equilibrium, where again the equilibration here is not in terms of a cost function as a nonlinear function of flows, but instead as cost functions with capacities. All right, so the first step in making the HAP model more multimodal, first we need to give a little bit more description about what the HAP model does, right? So in essence, the HAP model is a pickup and delivery problem. So it's a class of a vehicle routing problem where you are able to generate, you know, from a depot. In this case, the depot is the home, a set of routes such that you're picking up and dropping off activity performance. So here the goods that you're picking up and dropping off are not actual physical goods, but it's the need to participate in some activity, right? So when you pick up the activity, you're participating in the activity, and when you drop off the activity, you have to go home, and that drops off the activity. So having that pick up and drop off kind of mechanism allows you to consider going on trip chains or going on multiple trips from home to some activity and back to home to go to another activity. If we did not use a drop off and instead just use going to, you know, consider just like vehicle routing problem with visiting multiple nodes, we wouldn't be able to consider the case of people going back home each time. So that's why we look at it as a pickup and delivery problem, right? So it's analogous to finding a shortest path. It's like a shortest path problem for activity space. And in this activity space, we assume we have individual objective coefficients where we calibrate beforehand from baseline data. We also assume there's a spatial temporal constraint matrix, right? So these would be flow conservation constraints and such. And that's represented by A matrix for simplicity. And this A matrix would be the same for every person in the population. The BI right-hand side of those constraints would then be customizable to individuals. So these could be let's say arrival time constraints, for example. It's like a person needs to get to work, they desire to get to work at a certain time of the day. So these can be customized to individuals that way, right? So for each individual, this is this shortest path problem for activities is essentially an agent-based model, because you're setting up this operator as a rule for each individual in a household. It operates as such, where you're given a set of the betas, the A matrix, the BIs, and it'll output a set of routes, the XIs, and a set of arrival times, the TIs, for each of the locations. Right, and this problem is has been formulated as a mixed integer linear programming problem. So that's what this is. And you have two sets of nodes. You have the drop-off nodes as well as the corresponding home return nodes, which all are placed within the home to allow people to go home to before going to another activity. Okay, so what we do differently in this new model is that so what you see here is the original HAP model. This is what it handles. It's basically looking at a person going from home to different activities, and it's the routing is determining the directionality of the flows for this individual or this household. What we do differently is that we've expanded it so that there are multiple transport nodes. So you have these sets of transport nodes for different modes in a directed graph structure now. So a person can, let's say, go from home to a bus stop 1, take a bus to bus stop 2, get off there, walk over to compulsory activity 1 or compulsory activity before they maybe go to a parking lot, pick up a shared vehicle, drive over to parking lot 2, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. So it's possible to develop a path, activity path like that as a feasible path. And we can make it sensitive to different mode preferences by incorporating mode-specific constant utilities with the betas that we can calibrate from the data so that we add that as an objective. we also need to introduce new variables to account for the times that vehicles are parked in facilities. So this allows us to decouple travelers from their vehicles, so that we're also keeping track of the cost of parking, for example. Right. So if you leave your car at a parking facility for 10 hours and the parking facility charges at an hourly rate, you can incorporate that into this variable, using this variable. Right. But the problem here with this structure, we still do not. If you're familiar with vehicle routing problems, right? Basically, each node that is shown here can only be visited once. Okay, so and you're setting up essentially a chain, right? as I mentioned, the home node would be duplicated multiple times for each of the drop-offs for each of these activities. So there would actually be three home nodes here, one for the original home node, one for dropping off of the compulsory activity, and one for dropping off of secondary activity. But for these, you know, for moving on to these bus stops, we want to make it possible for a person to use the bus stop multiple times, right? So we need a way to account for that. So to do that, we changed the indexing a little bit. It's a little bit more complex, but it works in a way where we're indexing based on the activity OD pattern that they're taking. So, for example, here, if I'm taking a bus stop, if I'm going to bus stop 1, I am going there because perhaps I'm going from home zone to compulsory activity, and I might take bus stop 1 a second time because I'm taking a trip from secondary activity to home zone. And each of those activity OD pairs results can allow me to take a bus stop 1 a different time, right? So in this way, I don't assume I can take bus stop 1 multiple times for home zone to compulsory activity, but that's not necessary because realistically, people won't really do that for the same activity purpose, right? You would just end up creating a separate node in the case where you want to look at the you know, a different trip from that same case. Okay, so in this way, we're able to visit these stops, these transport nodes, multiple times in the same directed graph structure. And so to illustrate how this model would work, we can formulate this as a mixed integer programming problem, just like the original HAP model. The objective is a linear sum of these various component objectives, such as minimizing modal costs, that, as I showed you earlier, travel time, which is pretty a standard, parking cost, which we can add in now because of the new variables. Mode-specific disutility, trip chaining, out-of-home time, and we would add in the constraints. So we would have constraints that require you to visit compulsory activities and home zones, and for secondary activities, you can make that optional by having inequalities. for locations that are visited, you have to have ins equal to outs, so you would have constraints for that. For the parking facilities, you have to keep track of those to make sure that if you're driving in, you're walking out, and if you're if you did drive in, you have to eventually come back and pick up the car again. So you can add in constraints for those. you have to have the user schedule preference constraints. So this is your goal arrival time for each individual with their actual arrival time and the penalties, that non-negative arrival time penalties associated with that goal arrival time. Trip chaining constraints, so that if you arrive at a location at a certain time, then dropping off of for that activity has to be at a later time. Departure time constraints, parking duration constraints, system schedule constraints, ultimately, the output of this model for a single individual household is a set of binary route variables, 1 or 0, that indicate which pattern you're taking, and continuous variables representing your arrival times at the nodes that you are participating in your activities in, as well as the arrival times to the different transport nodes, so you know when you arrive at the bus stops, for example, as part of this shortest path problem. Activity path problem, and the parking durations based on the differences in the queues, right? Okay, so all that ends up giving us this equivalent activity-based shortest path problem, but we haven't yet aggregated that up to the population level, right? So some of you might be wondering how we get to that population level now. I bring back the column generation approach for the multi-commodity flow problem again. So in the multi-commodity flow problem, to reiterate, the one way to solve that using column generation is you start by assigning feasible flows along a set of paths. You update the Lagrange multipliers according to the binding link capacity constraints, where the capacities are binding, and using those updated Lagrange multipliers, you would then solve shortest paths for each of those OD pairs as subproblems using the updated reduced cost of those links using those updated Lagrange multipliers. And if you generate new paths from these shortest path subproblems, you would add those to the set and you would return to step one and repeat. Right, so that's the column generation approach for the multi-commodity flow problems. And we will use a similar setup for the activity-based scheduling assignment problem, where in this case our MHAP is the shortest path subproblem per individual. But we need to keep in mind also, because for the MHAP, we're generating this practically from a set of individuals that are really a subset, right? We're not assuming we're able to get the MHAP model for every person in the population. That's not realistic. Right, so we're getting this from a subset, a sample S of the population, where we assume we can get the travel patterns, and we're able to calibrate those models for them. So we're able to use that as an operator for that subset of the population. But from there, we need to be able to aggregate up the preferences under different design alternatives to a population level. So we use a stochastic user equilibrium with a mixed logit model framework for this, and that's what I'll talk about here. Okay, so to aggregate it up to a population level, let's start by recalling the mixed logit model. So in the mixed multinomial logit model, the utility function is as you see here, right? You have the utility for alternative J for individual I is a sum of these attributes XJIs with these betas, where in the mixed multinomial logit model, the betas are normally distributed across the population. Right? So one individual might have a beta of negative 0.33, another individual might have a beta of negative 0.5. We assume in the MHAP model, because the MHAP model is also structured like a utility function, the betas for each of the individuals that we calibrate, we're getting different betas for each of those individuals, right? So what we can do then, because they're structured in the same way, where we can look at this Well, first, for the mixed logit model, for us to determine the probability of a person taking a certain alternative J, we can use simulated sampling of the sampling draws of the betas to get a mean value of the preference for a certain alternative. Right, so that's taking you randomly draw some sets of these parameters from the normal distributions because it's a multivariate normal distribution. Plug those in into these utility functions. You get a sample average of the probabilities for these, and you can get and you can use that to as an estimate of the probability for choosing a certain alternative based on these distributed betas. So in the case of the MHAP, what we do is if we assume the sample of individuals that we're able to get the fitted MHAP models for are the set of sample draws, right? Then essentially these MHAP samples are the sample draws of the mixed logit model. So if you take those as, so instead of beta JRs, we're saying that the ones that we calibrated, the beta JS, are our betas for the MHAP, and we can use that as a, if we just take an MNL of the MHAP objective values, we actually get a mixed logit assignment for the population. And I'll illustrate that in the next slide. So this is how we would actually do that. So this probability is what we saw in the prior slide, where you're now taking the betas from the each of the individuals, but keeping into account, we add in this indicator for whether or not an individual is using a schedule J that falls under that is using a link UW in the network. Okay, so this is an indicator for whether they're using that network for this time interval. Okay, so this time interval phi A and phi B, okay, phi A, phi B, okay. And so we multiply the indicator function with the set of schedules where they're using the, where they have the set of schedules and the betas for each of those individuals. We can sum them up, divide them by the sample size, and multiply it by the population to scale it up to the population level. Right, the delta indicator function is determined by using a dynamic loading procedure. So basically, this delta is equal to 1 if schedule choice J includes link UW within time range this range or and 0 otherwise. Once you sum this up, this amount, this value, can be compared to the load capacity of that link to see if it's fitting, if it's binding along that capacity. And we can illustrate this. So suppose you have two schedules that run through a link. Schedule 1 enters link at 8:30 a.m., departs at 9 a.m. Schedule 2 enters the link at 8:50 a.m., departs at 9:20 a.m. If you set up a cumulative arrival diagram, you would get something like this, where the max load would occur within this time interval. And this would read as basically your interval would be 8:50 to 9, this delta would be equal to 1 for that interval because that's where the max load occurs. All right. So in summary of that aggregation process, graphically, this is what it looks like. We have a set of calibrated MHAPs of S set of individuals representing their activity schedule behavior that we can get from, let's say, travel surveys and such, GPS data. We feed a certain multimodal scenario, right, a multimodal network design scenario, maybe a certain parking facility capacity, or maybe a transit a schedule, a timetable. This would lead to a certain constraint matrix for these individuals, which would then output a set of schedules for these individuals. This set of schedules are used within the dynamic loading to get a capacitated stochastic usual equilibrium of the activity flows for the population, from which we update our dual prices, and we will keep repeating this until we get a fixed point. This fixed point has been shown by Martinez et al. To exist as a unique fixed point for constrained logit models. And as this is a constrained logit model, then we can show that it is a unique fixed point. All right. So now the question is, how do we get to this fixed point? We have this algorithm to do that based on column generation. So in the column generation algorithm, we initialize using by first setting all the dual variables equal to zero. We solve the m-haps for all the individuals in the sample. We update the time range in which any capacity is a binding constraint for that link. Using the updated time range, we determine the optimal lambda for that time range for that set. Using this updated dual price, we then resolve the m-haps for each of those sample individuals. Any new schedules that are generated are added to a set that we maintain. And from that new updated set, we would determine the auxiliary primal population flows using a constrained mixed logit distribution to get these flows. To make sure it's a smooth a set of flows that converge to the fixed point, we use a MSA to update these flows. So the new flows for the new iteration would be MSA based update from the prior flow update. If the MSA stopping criteria is reached, then we stop, else we keep going. So the properties of this algorithm are that the dual variables should be unique. The primal variables are based on mixed logit assignment. There could be different primal variables, but the ones based on the mixed logit assignment should be at least consistent with the logit mixed logit based SUE. It's not a unique allocation though. You can have different allocations that still fit the dual variables. The complexity of the MHAP models for the individuals is NP-hard, but in practice, because these are activity scheduling patterns, and in practice, people don't tend to schedule more than like a dozen activities and transport node choices a day. It shouldn't be problematic because we can have a very large network, but in the case of each individual, when we're solving the MHAP, the individual's sub-network is very small, right? So we conducted several computational experiments using this model. The design of the experiments, there's two stages of this these experiments. The first was to illustrate this model, which is what this is discussing, and then the second, we apply it to a last mile a problem case study. All right, so for the simple network experiment, we wanted to first show that the MHAP the extension does work with the new transport nodes and the new flow structure. We also wanted to show that when applying the load capacity, the proposed algorithm does converge as expected. The results using this converged a solution compared to the initial solution without any interaction, we should be able to highlight differences between them. We first construct this simulated scenario where we have a population of 1,000 people who live in this suburb region, this home zone, that go to CBD for work, but there's also some people that might prefer to go shopping. So the shopping activity is a secondary activity. It's non-compulsory. They can choose to either drive they're assumed to have their cars at home at the home zone. Okay, so they can either choose to drive directly to parking lot one to go to work. They can choose to drive to parking lot two to go shopping. They can walk to a transit station one to take transit to transit station two, and then walk to CBD. And all the links can be set up. There's 26 links in total for this setup. So it's not that big actually for example of the size. So we can run the model. So if we assume that this link here, this basically this corridor, this bottleneck from the suburb down to CBD is capacitated with a load capacity of 200 people. We can see a certain pattern that results. So we created three classes of the population out of the 1,000 people. Right, so some people prefer transit. These people will end up. So 500 of the people prefer transit. They end up just taking this this approach. Since I didn't capacitate the transit, there's no changes in this. For the other two classes, they have different preferences. So we use different parameters for the objective functions, and we showed that if you run it initially without any interaction. These are the routes that they would choose. So this is saying they go from 0 to 6 to 1 to 6 to 7 to 2 to 7 to 4, which is going back home. 4 is the drop-off for work for the CBD, and also to unload 3 and also to end the day at 5. So that's an example of one route. And these are arrival times in minutes. So that's like a 9, around 9 a.m., I believe. and there's about this number of, well, initially there's a lot more of the flow over there. but this doesn't account for interactions between the travelers, right? So we iterate multiple times, and these new schedules are generated over multiple iterations. And these are the flows that are assigned to them in the capacitated mixed logic assignment. And we can see how the MSA iterations converge on the lower bound of the objective value. And we also can illustrate, this is the resulting load on that link from 0 to 6, that bottleneck, without any interactions. But once we add in the constraints to have the multiple MSA iterations, this is the resulting flow by time of day on that link. The resulting load, the arrival diagram. And interesting insight that we saw from this is that the effect is kind of similar, that we can model something similar to Vickrey's bottleneck effect, right? Where we have having a capacity, we can see the dispersion of the this departure times. Although in this case, it's a more generalized effect, looking at activity schedules changing in response. And also the capacity is not a flow capacity, just a load capacity. All right, so I'm getting close to running at the end of the time, so I'll speed up a little bit over here. For the case study, we wanted to look at some real data and apply some insights to last mile problem in transit, where people are accessing transit stations from the suburbs. So we looked at a GO station, which is one of the commuter rail stations in the Greater Toronto Area. We got travel diary data from a University of Toronto. We fitted some parameters to that. We set up the activity network similar to what we did earlier. And we're able to evaluate the situation. So one of the problems that the operators of GO Transit were facing was that their parking facilities were getting very full, and they were pondering whether they should add a pricing to the parking facilities for people doing park and ride. And we can model the higher resolution time of day occupancy on the parking facility or accessing the parking facility by time of day now because of the use of this model. Right? So you can see arrivals with the capacity versus without the capacity. You can see the change in the load. Similarly, we can evaluate changes in the parking fee because of the decoupling of the travelers and the vehicles. We can quantify the effects of having parking fee on the access mode share. So people, whether they choose to drive to the parking facility to take transit to downtown, or whether they take another feeder bus service, and quantifying the effect on their disutility. So we can see that there's an increase in disutility because of the parking fee. All right, so to wrap up, in essence, this work has solved a 20-year-old problem since Record first introduced this HAP assignment, activity assignment model for individuals, because at that time there was no interactions between the agents, but this is the first model to really consider interactions between them. We use this as a model of scheduling demand forecasting that is sensitive to multimodal system designs, where we feel that there's a lot more need for these, because in this age right now we're seeing a lot more service systems, so you know, shared mobility, multimodal services, they're requiring new paradigms of analytical tools to look at these types of models. This work is applicable to other related work as well, so we can consider using these as a part of ensemble or multi-model transportation planning methods, where planners might make use of multiple models, where they might have a core model that focuses on long-range planning and typical scenarios, but for spatial temporal scenarios, they might fit this as an additional model to gain some more insight. We can also consider looking at integrated agent learning, because the MHAP is an agent-based model along with system design. So we can consider dynamic agent learning and system design approaches in the future. And that's an area that I'm looking into right now. Shortcomings, this work is not designed for long-term regional planning model in the sense that this shouldn't serve as the core model. Because it is very data intensive and it's also very computationally intensive, so it's more suited for looking at specific problems related to evaluating spatial temporal scenarios. We haven't implemented this for multiple link capacities at the time of this publication. We did not look at node capacities at the time of the of this study, although theoretically it should work for it, but we didn't look at that. We have not explicitly considered shared use of flexible systems in this model case yet, and also the model itself, as I mentioned, it doesn't consider congestion effects, so the traffic flow properties in here are very simplistic. So as the load increases, the travel time stays constant until it'll hit a capacity. So that's the structure of the travel time, the density, which is not very realistic. So if we wanted to look at more realistic traffic patterns, we might want to look at some more sophisticated cases. All right, and that pretty much wraps up the presentation. And you're welcome to ask me any questions now, or if you can think of some questions later on, you're welcome to contact me separately offline. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. A very nice presentation. I guess you plan to send the slides to me, and I'm going to publish them online. So for those who have questions after this seminar, please feel free to contact Joe. And this time, you're welcome to raise any questions. The simplest way is unmute yourself and speak out from the microphone, and everybody will hear you. Or if you want to take some time to organize your thoughts and words, you may use the chat box, which is one component on this GoToWebinar control console. And when you send out your chat messages, please make sure that you select send to organizers and panelists only. Again, organizers and panelists only. It's just a little bit awkward here, so you have to select organizers and panelists only to be able to have your questions seen by everyone. Okay, so at this time, I would encourage you raise questions. All right, I think while others are organizing their questions, I may just throw out something off the top of my mind, and later on people may just raise better questions. So Joe, it's a very interesting, and I can see the computational complexity of this kind of network optimization problems, and you mentioned something that you had a relatively simple assumption about the capacity, a traffic flow property, that is there is a single capacity, and I think you know, my intuition is it might not be that difficult to extend that, you know, relax that assumption if you want to use piecewise linear constraint. So I don't know actually, but if you can, you can use piecewise linear constraint in that they're formulated in linear form, and then you can relax them in a similar manner.
I agree. I think that you can definitely. So in this study, we only had a you know, we were looking at a single capacity, and there's no nonlinear effects. But I think you can incorporate them, as you say, with piecewise linear functions in there. It's just a matter of, you know, asking, you know, what kind of questions you want to ask of it. So if that is a concern that you want to look into, that's something you consider. One thing to keep in mind though is that this is looking at these facilities throughout the day, right? So it's in the scale of hours. So that was one reason we justified not looking specifically at the way the congestion might occur, right? So we looked at it instead of just as a load capacity, primarily to study facilities like parking facilities and or local access networks and such. But I can see, yeah, we can definitely look into that. But I think the scaling is an issue, like an assumption that we need to look into more carefully if we wanted to try to fit it closer to traffic patterns.
Yes, you, in your case study, you actually showed the analysis over parking lot. But in the end, you said you didn't consider any node capacity, right? So
yeah.
You actually didn't consider the capacity for that parking lot.
Yeah, so for the case study, we didn't consider the capacity for the parking lot. We only looked at capacity of the local access network. So we treated that as a macroscopic link, I guess. The whole access network was a link to access the facility, the terminal.
Right. That is not equivalent to parking capacity, right? Parking is like inventory, and link capacity is like a flow rate.
Yeah, yeah. Right. But in this case, we're looking at the load capacity.
Right.
But okay. It should be pretty straightforward to look at it at the parking facility, and in hindsight, I think we should have looked at it that way. But definitely it shouldn't be a problem to do that.
Right. Okay. I see you got some question from the audience from Xuesen Zhou from Arizona State.
Hi, Xuesen. Thanks for your question. So your question is talking about a high temporal solution. So in our case, the arrival times are not discretized into time intervals. We have the exact times that they arrive in. So it allows us to look at the departure times and arrival times at a more higher. When we say higher resolution, we're saying we're not just looking at trips in either, you know, a single time period, or whether it's looking at people arriving at a set of discrete time intervals, but instead allowing them to kind of, you know, where we can have a continuous range for where they set the maximum capacity for the time interval. So it would be fitted to the based on what we see from the data, I would guess. But your question about the Lagrangian relaxation price vector could be time dependent and quite large. In our case, that's why we set a Lagrange multiplier. It at this stage is not indexed by time interval because of that. So we just have a multiplier that is based on the interval that is defined by the binding the maximum load that occurs on that link. So it ends up being just one price for one link, as opposed to one price per time in discrete time interval on that link.
Okay.
I also want to add that yeah, I acknowledge like some of the work that Shizong's been doing with the like the time discrete time interval approaches for the routing problems, and I can definitely see it, you know, at a large scale implementation, that might be a method that we can incorporate into this type of model for looking at individual travel patterns throughout the day.
In fact,
that's something that we've I'm working with a collaborator right now at a City College, and we're taking a look at some of that work too that she's also been doing.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, any other questions from the audience? All right, if not, let's thank again Dr. Chow for his interesting presentation and you know, very nice work, and thank all of you for attending this seminar again. And the next seminar will be next week afternoon 1 p.m. Washington DC time, and look forward to seeing you again. With this, the seminar adjourns, and hope you all have a good weekend.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.